So let's now talk a little bit about the JavaScript programming language. So JavaScript is a programming language. And it's just like other languages, it has its little quirky things. So JavaScript was informed by lots of languages that came before it. It has two basic forms of comments. One is a double slash, which is like a C++ form of a comment that says from here to the end of the line. And you can also have multi-line comments that start with slash star to end, and that's like a C language comment, which, you know, this is what we like. We like both single-line comments and multi-line comments in JavaScript, and that's quite nice. White space and new lines do not matter, although we, you know, rigorously indent to make our code easier to read. Statements end in semicolon. There's places you can leave the semicolon off, but it's a little different than Java and C and other C-like languages, but most programmers just program as if they were in Java and put all the semicolons in, and don't try to remember the complex rules as to when you don't need semicolons. So here's a good example of white space that simply does not matter, right? You know, here is, you know, x equals 3 plus 5 times 4. It doesn't matter if there's a new line or lots of white space. The same is true if there's a new line. I mean, it's as if that white space, a new line, doesn't exist. Variable names are pretty typical. The only thing that's kind of weird is you can have dollar signs. They're optional. I'm not sure exactly quite why JavaScript allowed this. I think sometimes language designers are trying to appeal to people coming from different languages, and so maybe people coming from PHP or Perl might have felt more comfortable. The problem is that if you're in a file where you're mixing PHP and JavaScript, it's sort of considered tacky to use the dollar sign in your JavaScript code. You want to really use that in your PHP code. PHP requires dollar sign. JavaScript allows it, but again, we tend not to do it, okay? But other than that, it's pretty much standard stuff. Start with a letter, case matters, underscore. We tend to use underscores for variables that are internal, that are, you don't just have random underscore variables unless it's sort of like global variables or internal variables or some kind of a special variable. String constants are nice. Single quotes and double quotes kind of work the same. You have things like new lines that work in either single quotes or double quotes. Again, not all languages are similar like this. Single quotes, but they're equivalent. But what we tend to do is we tend to use single quotes in our JavaScript constants, unless we absolutely need to use double quotes, because we want to use double quotes for the HTML elements. And sometimes you're writing JavaScript that's writing HTML. And so it's nice to sort of, in your mind, just say if it's double quote, we're using an HTML. If it's a single quote, it's a JavaScript string constant. And it uses standard C-like backslash, either in single quote or double quoted strings. Clicking the wrong place to clear the screen, but we got this screen cleared. Numbers, floating point, integers, just exactly what you would expect. We'll talk a little bit in another lecture about more detail about arrays, but if you just have a standard array, the syntax is pretty natural. You have their zero based and use the index operator with square brackets, and so kind of like lists and integer indexed arrays in PHP as well. Standard operators, plus, minus, modulo. We have our post increment, which is, you know, K++ is, you know, pull out the value for K and then add one. I'm using the console here. I'm actually just typing these into the console. K++ says, give me the old value of K and add one. And that's why K is 4. This is a predecrement, which means take out the 4, subtract 1, put it back in, and give me the post-decrement value. So, don't use those too much. But we do use modulo, and we use plus, minus, and those guys like that. So operators are pretty basic. Like many C-like languages, we have the side effect operators, plus equals, minus equals, star equals, standard side effect operators. Comparison operators are very much like C and very much like PHP, in that there's also a triple equals as well as a double equals, where there's less conversion going on, and the triple equals is kind of like equivalent to where there's no type conversion going on, much like PHP, actually. Logical operators, again, like PHP, double AND is AND, double ampersand is AND, double vertical bar is OR, and NOT is exclamation point. String concatenation. This is probably the part when I switch from one language to another that drives me nuts. I like how PHP uses the dot, but JavaScript uses the Java and other languages' more common syntax of plus for concatenation. And it does do aggressive type conversion where needed, and so it there's no like string function or anything like that that you might use in Python. You concatenate a string in an integer, and it's like, oh, I'll turn that integer into a string for you, and it concatenates, okay? Variables, of course, have types. It is a little counterintuitive. Like, for example, here we're adding a string and a number. In PHP, we would expect that to be a number, but in JavaScript, it's a string. Here we're doing a multiplication, so that's going to turn that into a number and then add 10 to it, so we get a number. And then you will see in JavaScript this thing called NaN. Okay, NaN is a floating point concept called not a number. And that usually you get it by dividing by zero or doing something else illegal. And you'll see it often in dynamic web pages where you'll see NaN and you're like, oh, that means JavaScript's in action and probably divided by zero or something like that. NaN is sticky. So like if X ends up being Fred times one, it has no idea what to do with that, although PHP would know what to do with that. Fred times one is not a number, but then not a number stays not a number. If I can add one to it, not a number plus one is still not a number. So it's kind of a sticky value. Once you end up with a computation that's not a number, there is no way to do more computations to that value and change it back to a number. It does variable conversion. It's a little bit different. We can also end up with infinity by dividing by zero by mistake. There is an isNaN function, and so we can do these kinds of things, but in general, we just sort of avoid doing silly things like multiplying Fred by one or dividing an integer by zero in JavaScript. So these are just some functions that you can play with. There is an operator called typeof, which basically tells you what kind of a thing you've got, and it returns a string. And so type of y, because, you know, that's crazy, y is equal to quote W-H-Y question mark, and it is a string. And so you can check, and you can also find out if something is undefined by looking at the type of an undefined variable. Functions are as you would expect. The keyword is function, and you got a function name followed by your arguments. And of course, the arguments are really just temporary placeholders, so that they kind of correspond to the call, first and second thing, and they sort of work, and there's a return, and the return value becomes the residual in the expression from whence it was called. That part all looks pretty straightforward. The thing that's not straightforward, and I find it really annoying, really annoying, because in this respect, JavaScript works differently than virtually every other language that I'm used to, that any of us are used to, and that is, if a variable exists, like this GL variable, if that variable exists before the function sort of is defined, then this GL is a global GL. Not because I called it GL, but just because it goes like, oh, does GL exist? And it does, so I'll just hook those two things together. So if you look at this code, right, it sets GL to 123, this function is defined that changes GL to 456. We call the function, and then we print out GL at the end. And the global GL, the outer GL, the GL outside the function, has been changed to 456 because this hooks up with that global variable. Okay? Counterintuitive. In every other sane language, this GL would be a local GL within that function, right? But that's not particularly sane. So we have to sort of have a way of overriding that. In any sane language, you'd say have to say global to make it escape the bonds of the function. But in JavaScript, we use the var keyword to force it to be local. So you'll see var all the time. Var says, make this a local copy. And even if there is a global version of it, then this is local. And that's why when this code runs, the global 123 is separate from the local 123. And it stays 123 globally. Now, let's talk a little bit about arrays. JavaScript supports both linear arrays and key value associative arrays, but they're kind of actually a little different than associative arrays in PHP. So linear arrays are really simple. You can effectively append into them, and then you have a linear array. You can create an array. Looks a lot like PHP there. And then you can set the zero item and the one item. That works as well. And then you just print them out, and you've got an array that's just got two items in it, and away you go, and use the index operator as you might expect. You can also use the array constructor, where you say array, and then you have a thingy and a thingy, and you got a two-item list. Or you can use the constant syntax, which is square brackets, and you get the same kind of a thing. Let's talk a little bit about control structures for JavaScript. They're very much like most of them. If statements work like you would expect, while loops work like you'd expect, counted for loops work like you'd expect, and in loops break and continue work like you'd expect, because it's all very C influenced. So here is the definite loop for for, the in, right? And so if we have a, in this case, this is an object with three member variables, for ball and balls, that's going to sort of iterate. Ball is now going to iterate through these three things. And if we print out golf, which is a string, and then we look up balls sub ball, so that is a string, balls sub golf, balls sub tennis, so it prints these guys out, right? So that's an in. It uses the in keyword similar to Python.